For the Los Angeles Review of Books, I'm Colin Marshall, coming to you from LARB HQ in Silver Lake, Los Angeles, California, sitting down with Nathaniel Rich, author of three books, San Francisco Noir, The Mayor's Tongue, his first novel, and his second novel, brand new, Odds Against Tomorrow. Nathaniel, when did you first start thinking about, how to put it, the utility of fear, how fear is useful?
Well, I started writing the novel in 2007, and I wanted to write about obsession, and I feel like the obsession of our time, of our culture, is fear. And, you know, you can't go an hour without being reminded of some horrible thing that is coming for us, whether it's antibiotic-resistant superflus, war, nuclear exchanges between the Koreas or with Iran and Israel, random acts of terrorism. You know, that's just in the last week as we record this. So I wanted to write about these things, and I wanted to write about it in a relatable way through a story and through a character who's able to experience the sort of wide range of emotions and sort of intellectual responses to living in a world of constant anxiety, which is a world I'm personally probably familiar with. And, you know, I mean, I tend towards neuroses probably in some ways more than other people. And this allowed me to really get down to the bottom of what should we be afraid of, but also, you know, what's real, what's pretend. And also what is all this fear doing to us? How is it shaping us? And so I had these general ideas about, these ideas I wanted to write about, and I had started with a character, and it grew out of that.
And this character, he is fixated on ingesting and internalizing more and more and more disaster data, first personally, then professionally. And I was going to ask, you know, what is your experience being fascinated by the possibility of disaster? Everybody has been that, I would say. To what degree have you been that?
Well, when I was writing this novel, I absolutely obsessed. I mean, I went out.
You had to write the novel, right?
I had to. And I've, you know, I think like a lot of people, I've gone through these sort of internet wormholes of, you know, going to the, for instance, the USGS website where they plot the readings in Yellowstone, the Yellowstone supervolcano, right? There's this huge supervolcano. I didn't know about this until I started researching the book. That has gone off twice in the history of the planet that we know. And both times it's essentially destroyed all living things. And the first time it happened was 2.1 million years ago. It happened again about a million years ago. And we're, roughly speaking, we're due. You know, so I wanted to figure out, well, what are the odds that this can actually happen? And you can go now on this website and watch the USGS monitor every little ripple in the ground. And people comment on, you know, is this the one? You know, is this the one where that ends all life on Earth? You know, and so I had moments of obsession, and I also went out of my way to write, to take on nonfiction assignments during the 5 years that I was working on the novel. That allowed me both to do research for the novel, but also to do a different type of research and spending time with people who are obsessed with terrifying things. So I did a piece, for instance, for Harper's about people who are convinced that cell phones cause brain cancer, and in 15 years we're going to be facing the greatest human health epidemic emergency ever, brain cancer plague. And so I was looking for ways to, you know, both write about the actual facts of the matter and go deep into the facts, into the numbers, but using that more as a platform to get into these larger, more amorphous fears and themes about, you know, what are these fears doing to us, and how do we deal with them? And, you know, do we ignore them? Do we become cynical? Do we become activists, anti-electromagnetic field activists, for instance? I get their emails every day. And I'm still on all the lists. Or is there some other way out? And so that's what I wanted to really get to the bottom of.
What, to your mind, is the difference between fear and worry?
Well, I guess it's a question of degree, fear and worry. And, you know, and then there's just sort of free-floating anxiety, which I think is in some ways the modern condition. And I think it's you know, I was asked this question recently, and someone mentioned 9/11, and I think for a lot of people our generation who, you know, experienced, you know, bad things before 9/11, but didn't feel implicated in the same way or assaulted in the same way, and that just a total chaos out of nowhere could arrive and change the world as we knew it. That hadn't happened for people born in the 80s, you know? Mm-hmm. And so, I think since then, I think I can trace back a lot of my own kind of worries to that period in a kind of loose way. You know, I was never afraid of flying. Mm-hmm. And after that, though, I didn't connect it directly with 9/11. I started to become a little anxious about what the hell is happening. We're in the middle of the air. Mm-hmm. How is this magical thing working? It seems like I'm violating some rule of nature, you know, little things like that. Started to become kind of secondhand, and I don't know if that's a common experience or not, but I felt, looking back, when I started writing the book, you know, 10 years later, I guess, or 8 years after 9/11, I started to wonder, does it derive from that in some way? Has this sort of changed the climate? And I think it has to some degree, and also just this sort of steady looming concern about climate change and all of this, if its many manifestations that it might have for us in the future that we'll have to live with, is kind of a looming worst case scenario that is always percolating. Mm.
This novel, Odds Against Tomorrow, is a disaster story. Not like a disaster story I've read before, though. I mean, you open with a disaster, the destruction of Seattle in an earthquake, which I guess is one of these inevitabilities. Is that true?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there were two disasters that I wrote about that I included in the book. I mean, it starts with Seattle, and then there's a hurricane hitting New York. And I chose both of them because they're both extremely, if not likely to happen very soon, it's very plausible that they would. So Seattle is on this enormous fault line, biggest fault line in North America. And the last time there was a mega earthquake there, it was about 300 years ago. They've recurred at about a rate of every 300 years. Mm-hmm. And the last time, you know, an earthquake hit there, it was felt in Japan. And people who live in Seattle, you know, scientists there, they know that one is going to come. And so, yeah, it's inevitable. It's a matter of time, whether it happens tomorrow or 50 years from now or 100 years from now, that you can't really predict. But yeah, a large hurricane hitting New York is the same way. Also an inevitability. It's happened before. In the 19th century, there was a storm that caused the East River and the Hudson River to meet at about Soho. Mm. And so that actually, you know, a big storm actually did hit New York right before the novel was done being edited, which is a whole nother story. But yeah, these are things that, you know, most of the scenarios in the books are inevitabilities. It's just a question of time.
How central to the story is the question of, well, the fact that nobody seems to be able to agree how likely something has to get before you start preparing?
Yeah, well, there's some question of, you know, we have to, Mitchell has to prioritize, well,
this is the main character in your book.
Yeah, Mitchell Zucker is the main character. He's a math genius who works at Future World, this mysterious consulting firm in Manhattan, where his job is to predict worst case scenarios in a kind of, he's developed a kind of market in high catastrophe. Sells his wisdom about worst case scenarios to his corporate clients, and he becomes obsessed. And yeah, so part of what the job is to actually figure out in a very detailed way what is likely to happen and when. Mm. And yeah, and some things I learned are not very likely to happen, like an asteroid hitting the planet. I think right. We're safe with that. That's not going to happen in a really long time. And by the time it does, we'll be able to deflect it, you know, have some shield. But there are other things that are more likely to happen. But, you know, in a certain sense, you could say, I mean, the answer to your question could be, well, we don't really need to worry about any of this because it's all out of our control. And if something happens, we can't stop it. And that's fate. And I think that's something else I wanted to write about, is the convenience of obsessing over worst case scenarios as a kind of emotional procrastination and a way to avoid dealing with things that you do have control over in your life. So it's a lot easier to go on the USGS website, you know, and obsess over the readings of the ground in Yellowstone instead of worry about, you know, maybe fixing your relationship with your parents or your girlfriend, or calling that friend that you've fallen out of touch with, but you've heard something's happened to them and you want, you know, those types of little intimate personal crises are actually higher stakes in one's life. Mm-hmm. But worrying about things like a nuclear Iran or sea level rise, I think, can be a convenient way out. And so I wanted to write about the tension between the sort of public crises and private, intense, emotional, personal crises.
It's one of the central ironies of the book, is it not, that Mitchell, your protagonist, he opiates his anxieties about disaster by computing the odds of disaster. I mean, would you say that?
Yeah, I think that's well put. I like that verb, opiate. Yeah, he basically, his method is to console himself by doing the math, finding out the odds, and almost in every case, the odds are so low that something bad will happen that he kind of he's able to feel better about himself. But it's a vicious cycle, because the more information he learns, the more obsessed he gets. And as he cures himself of one anxiety, you know, he's not, might not be worried about asteroids anymore. He finds out about some new type of antibiotic resistant super flu that's migrating from India, you know, west. Mm. And so it's not a sustainable way of life.
It's a vivid image in the book. He computes the odds of these things happening, and you know, you compute the odds of a super flu that does something like that, and it's 0.0000, and all the zeros Mitchell sees is like pills that are taking away his anxiety, right? I mean, for you, reading about these disasters in the book, research or not, how many zeros did it take to pill away that anxiety? How many opiate pills did you need?
Well, to be honest, I don't get too worked up about, I never got to a Mitchell level panic about any of these things, really. I mean, I was quite disturbed to hear about the super volcano, quite disturbed to learn about this antibiotic resistant flus and all of that. But I think there's something really fun also about disaster, about catastrophe and chaos. And there's something almost liberating about it, because once you know that anything can happen and that we're doomed in so many different ways, it has a focusing effect, right? It forces you to actually worry about things that you can control. And I think it's, you know, I think that's how Mitchell experiences it in the novel too. It becomes a kind of noise that ultimately, I think, to mature, you know, the process that he goes through, the evolution that he undergoes over the course of the novel, is he moves on from that place. And yeah, they're pills, because he's an addict. You know, he's addicted to fear. And I feel like that's where we're at culturally. But I think in order to live your life in a sane way, you have to be able to move beyond that.
I remember when we were probably teenagers, there was just this wave of disaster movies about volcanoes and earthquakes and all kinds of nonsense, Hollywood envisioning various cities destroyed. If it wasn't New York, as happens in Mitchell's New York, it was Los Angeles, where we sit now. What is it? I mean, since it's in your book, I mean, why do we not relish, but what fascinates us so much about seeing New York destroyed?
Well, I think New York certainly has a great symbolic power, and there's a whole history of films and literature about the destruction of New York. In fact, there's a great book by a scholar named Max Page about this. That's sort of a cultural history of writers and filmmakers destroying New York, you know? And I think part of it is, you know, disaster films in general, they allow you to, they're cathartic, right? They allow you to kind of exercise your greatest fears, see them played out in glorious ways, right? Like Independence Day, Dante's Peak, yeah, all of that stuff, Deep Impact. You know, they allow you to sort of confront some of these fears and then also feel a sense of relief that, you know, few things aren't that bad yet. But those films are filled with so many cliches and they're so extreme. And yeah, you always have that moment where it's like, Beijing, what happened? Beijing's gone. You know, Beijing's off the board. London's gone. We've lost London. You know, LA, so it's gone. And that kind of simplistic sort of broad brush approach is really fun, I think, at a movie, but I think ultimately to get a little more deeply into these issues and to understand more what's going on intellectually, what's going on emotionally, you have to push past that. So at every turn in the novel where there was any threat of it veering into Hollywood disaster, yes, motion picture situation, I very consciously went the other direction. Mm. So you don't see big explosions. You don't see, with maybe one exception, you know, landmarks underwater, the kinds of things you might see in like a Deep Impact. I was very purposefully trying to thwart any expectations of that kind of Hollywood thrill ride disaster pick idea, because it's ultimately, I think, a superficial treatment of a lot of these major themes that I think we do have to grapple with in a more serious way.
How did you figure out which disaster to use on New York, to inflict upon New York? I mean, you use one that is, I guess, actually possible, data-based, evidence-based, but why that one? Why the flooding?
Two reasons. I knew that, so Mitchell becomes obsessed with worst-case scenarios, and I wanted him to reach a point where he's basically having a breakdown, which happens, and then finally he's confronted with an actual worst-case scenario, and so really I chose the one that was the most likely, which is a hurricane hitting New York. It happens a lot.
And as you said, during editing, happened.
Yeah, it almost happened the year before that. I didn't expect it to happen on the scale of Sandy when I was writing the novel, you know, before it was published, but I knew it was a possibility. I mean, I had five or six hurricane seasons as I was writing the novel to endure, wondering, you know, is this the year I'm going to have to throw out my novel because it is a catastrophe actually does happen.
So is Sandy technically was it a worse hurricane than happened in the novel?
No, Sandy's a one, category one. Tammy in the novel is a category three, but it goes up to five. You know, I also, that's part of what we were talking about earlier. You know, I made a conscious decision not to have it be a five, because that's, although totally possible and will happen in some point in the future, that would move it into more apocalyptic territory. And a three is actually quite plausible. The threes hit different parts of America many times at quite a high frequency, right? So, but a storm hitting is very likely. And I'd studied previous cases where it had happened. And there were these fantastic government reports that are accessible. If you just go to the library, there's a great Army Corps of Engineers report from the mid-90s that lays out what would happen in a category four. Mm-hmm. And so I relied on that pretty heavily, toned it down slightly for the category three. And when Sandy hit, I didn't really have to, as it turned out, I didn't really have to change anything because those predictions were accurate. Mm-hmm. So... so it all derived out of research and the facts as we know it. And I thought, you know, I didn't want to go into terrorism, which has a whole other set of issues involved. I didn't want it to be political, you know, overtly political in that way. And I wanted something that was specific to New York. Mm. So a natural disaster of some kind. Yeah.
Now, you have logged many a year in New York yourself, but you live in New Orleans now, a city that is not a stranger to disaster. And tell me how much the Katrina is still in the consciousness of that place.
Yeah, it is quite profoundly. It's part of your daily life there. And, you know, I was in New York when Katrina hit. I read about it like everybody else. I was disturbed by the images that you know, we were shown. And I was, you know, aware of the basic facts, right? But moving there and seeing, you know, 5 or 6, now 7 years after the storm, the way that it persists, the way the trauma of the storm persists, and the way that the landscape was transformed physically. You see it every day there. And you see, you know, there are whole parts of the city that are basically still in ruins, or are totally overgrown with forest, and you still see the marks on the houses where they count the number of bodies found, and people are traumatized about it still, and you know, a lot of people didn't return, and it affects. It's part of the conversation. It's part of, you know, it's like in the air, it's in the water, and so living there, you know, and then I wrote a piece about the Lower Ninth Ward, the reconfiguration of the landscape there, you know, after the storm and what had happened in the 6 years that followed, and speaking with people in that neighborhood specifically, it definitely, it forced me to reevaluate some of the final sections of the novel. And so I did rewrite, the end of the novel, in part based on the experiences that I had to reflect, what I'd learned living in New Orleans.
Tell me that said, what is the appeal for a New Yorker such as yourself for post Katrina New Orleans as a place to live?
Well, it's a fascinating, you know, I don't have to tell you it's a fascinating place. Right. It has an extremely rich culture. It's a scent full of eccentrics, which I like. it's a place that's...
So far, New York has all these things, too. I want to hear the difference.
it has a lot of similarities in a way. I mean, it's a port city. People talk... So the New Orleans accent is kind of like a Brooklyn accent. Mm-hmm. I think there's some port dialect there that crosses over. There's a self-referential quality that you see in New York too, in a slightly different way. In that, I think in New York, you feel like whatever you're doing has global importance. There's that kind of level of the New York snobbiness, right? And in New Orleans, you feel like it has, it's sort of the same thing. Whatever's going on has global importance, but the whole globe is New Orleans. There's no one sort of sees outside of New Orleans. No one has any ambitions to, like, you know, if I make it big here, I'm going to go to New York. No one cares about anything outside of the city, and that's responsible for, you know, some bad things. And I mean, I think there are certain lessons that it can learn about good government, for instance, and so infrastructure, from other cities, but it also, there's a slight, you know, can create a closed-mindedness in some ways, but it also is responsible for all the glories of the city. And it's the strength of the culture, its iconoclasm, and as this sort of wonderful melting pot, that makes it such an exciting, you know, unique place to live. And now it's having this interesting moment where in the last couple of years, a lot of people have been moving in, a lot of New Yorkers. I've noticed since I've gotten there about 3 years ago, even. And there's, you know, in many ways it's helping the city. In other ways, I think people look askance at you know, transplants. So it's going through an interesting period, but it's an exciting place. It's a cheap place. You can be young and, you know, young. It's a great place for young artists, young writers, to work. And so it has a bohemian quality that New York doesn't have anymore. Mm. I mean, it made me realize, you know, it's like going to a dive bar in New Orleans makes you realize that dive bars in New York are really simulacra of dive bars. They're like prettified, you know.
Faux
dive bars. Yeah, you realize like, oh, yeah, in a real dive bar, yeah, there are holes in the ceiling. There's like, you know, pools of urine in the bathroom. Yeah.
Beers, you actually kind of don't want to be there.
Yeah, it's kind of uncomfortable, but beers are $1 or $2. And people are smoking, and it's, you know, and it's a, there's this kind of authentic thing there that is increasingly vanished from New York, or harder to find in New York, or you have to go further and further away from Manhattan to find it.
I remember reading an article from you in the New York Times, I believe, which was about the whole gentrification of Manhattan, then the gentrification of Brooklyn. And this is people, you write about the people, you're not necessarily among them, who see that as a kind of its own destruction. Like, this might as well be a flood to some people, right?
It's talking about New York specifically, or?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I mean, I think I grew up in New York, and so it's definitely, it's a strange feeling to go back to my really crappy neighborhood in Midtown where I grew up and see it become transformed into this yuppie paradise of hip bars and clubs and, you know, the sushi restaurant where nobody went to for 15 years. Now there's a line down the block. It's the same, yeah, same disgusting restaurant. Mm-hmm. So there's something, I'm a very nostalgic, sentimental person. And so I feel that something's lost that way. But it's part of New York. That's the history of New York, is it's constantly devouring itself and becoming something different, and you can't fight that.
If it wasn't always changing, you wouldn't want to be there necessarily, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there are negative things about it. There are, you know, it used to be that you could be an artist and poor and live in New York, and you can't anymore. So I think it can deaden the culture in ways. And you know, alternatively, like in New Orleans, you can now have a beautiful old historic place and pay very little rent and live cheaply and eat well and drink all night, you know, do whatever you want to do. And so it's become very attractive for many, many people. But it also, there's a danger in that everybody coming, flooding the city. I mean, that's not the best verb. Everybody, you know, moving, all these transplants moving into the city, then of course have an effect on the city itself and maybe ruin the things that attracted them to it. So this is a constant shifting dynamic. But yeah, I love being in New Orleans. It's a fascinating place to be. And I think it's been a really good place to work.
I mentioned you've also been an observer of San Francisco, and you talk about that quality of New Orleans where the world only extends to the city's borders. That kind of happens in San Francisco as well, doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I knew after college that I wanted to live in, the two American cities I wanted to live in were San Francisco and New Orleans. Mm. And San Francisco has a lot of similarities in these ways, I think, with New Orleans. Very self-referential, and it is its own culture. That's unmistakably San Francisco, you know. But I wonder if that's starting to change with what's going on in the tech industry now. It used to be that, like,
if you ask Rebecca Solnit, she will tell you.
Right. Yeah. Well, I mean, it used to be. It's funny, and she's now doing a book about New Orleans anthology. Yeah, and so it used to be when I lived there, and then I would go to New York. When I lived there and moved back to New York, or visited New York, every block would be different in New York. A year later, you know, half a year later since I was there last, and I would come back to San Francisco and nothing would be changed. And then years later, when I moved back to New York and would return to San Francisco, I would literally go down the same streets, run into the same people, nothing would have changed. And there was something really reassuring and nice about that, but that's now changing with the tech stuff. It's so crazily expensive. And it's now having a kind of the New York thing where blocks are different every time you return. That's been happening now for a few years. And I wonder, how far that's going to go.
I can't think of any movies or books that destroy San Francisco. Do you know of any? I feel like that city never gets destroyed in fiction. It's spared usually.
Yeah, there's a good sci-fi movie from the 50s. What is it? Like The Thing from the Sea, the thing that came from the sea. I think that San Francisco is sort of a nuclear, some kind of giant octopus comes and destroys the city. And there are earthquake movies. I think the film called San Francisco, a very old movie from the 30s, I think it's about the 1906 earthquake, if I remember correctly. Mm-hmm. But yeah, there aren't as many examples. I mean, I think New York is a very easy target for disaster films because of its symbolic power, and you don't get the same, I think, catharsis just destroying San Francisco, which, you know, gets destroyed all the time by earthquakes anyway. Or, you know, LA is sort of comes in second, I think, for destruction. But yeah, New York has a power that is all its own.
And it's the city that Mitchell, the protagonist of the new novel, chooses. It's a place he identifies himself with. And thus, everything bad that happens to New York, in some sense, he takes it as happening to his self. Does that make sense?
I think he identifies with New York in some ways, but it's scary to him as well. And I think, like other characters in the novel, I think he feels like if he's going to really make it, he has to go to New York. You know, it's the old line about New York. And yet he's frightened by, I think, the level of cynicism that he encounters there. So, you know, he works for this job where he's predicting worst case scenarios that actually terrify him. But the people he works with only see it as another way to leverage profit, you know, to use it as a wedge to separate corporations from their money. And that scares him, that kind of high corporate cynicism. So, part of his transformation in the novel is coming to terms with that and trying to not get sucked into that kind of New York, famous New York cynicism himself.
The firm Future World that Mitchell goes to work for, gets recruited by, is, I guess, it's a little like a reinsurance company, but it's also a scam, sort of. It's they They give insurance companies someone to blame if something goes catastrophically wrong, but they themselves don't have to do anything. Future World doesn't, except for spend all their time researching disasters, just to say they did, right?
Yeah, it's a little bit confusing. But yeah, no, it's essentially using a kind of legal loophole to make money in the same way. You know, it's on the order of a credit derivative, you know, swap or something. It's a kind of high finance chicanery that they've figured out, and which I figured out is completely possible. Mm. There's an opening for a future world today. Really? I mean, after 9/11, it became almost impossible to buy catastrophe insurance because the insurance companies got screwed because they had to pay out so much money. And so there's this real gap in the market, and that's something that Future World tries to exploit.
Mm. Why doesn't a future world exist yet, do you think?
Well, you need somebody to put into you need a line in the to be passed by the state senate. Mm. So that's sort of the one little extra thing I had to add to make it possible.
The law that lets them do that is in there in the reality of the book. And if it passed in reality, we would have some future worlds.
Yes, absolutely. Mm. Yeah, yeah.
This gets at another theme people talk about in the book, which is, oh, the sense that New York is also the headquarters of everything that's gone wrong financially in the past 10 years. So maybe if it got destroyed, that too would be swept away. You know, that's a current of thought you're familiar with, right?
Yeah, there's the cleansing quality of a flood. Yes. Yeah, you know, I try to, I read all of the old, you know, the flood myths, which are variations on Noah and his ark, although Noah is not, you know, the Bible. There are many examples that predate the Bible. And that's part of the attraction of it is, yeah, wiping clean the earth of all of the things that have gone wrong, which start with a clean slate. And that's absolutely a theme in the novel. And when that does happen, and Mitchell, near the end of the novel, is presented with a clean slate, I think only then he realizes that, well, that causes a bunch of other problems too.
Mm. Each character in the book, they have a different attitude toward disasters and toward the possibility of disasters, and they're scared by different things. What types of attitudes fascinated you before you started writing this book? As far as, you know, you have the Mitchells, of course, but what other ways of thinking about disaster, reacting to the prospect of disaster, seemed fascinatingly foreign to you?
Yeah, well, you have the Mitchells, and then you have the Elsa Bruners, who's this kind of counterweight to Mitchell, who's a character who has a serious heart condition, which is a real heart condition called Brugada syndrome, where you're totally fine, except any day your heart might just stop. And she's a character like a lot of people I know who maybe don't have the Brugada syndrome, but are, you know, fully educated people who are fully aware of all of the horrible things that could go wrong at any time or that are going wrong. Mm. And yet are filled with a kind of blithe optimism, and do things like start a cooperative farm in Maine, as yes. Elsa does, you know, yes. Like we sort of know people like this, right? And they go to the mountain school, you know, and there's something, there's a kind of idealism that is also baffling to me, you know, that the idea that you can just sort of not worry about anything and, you know, plant your own garden. And there's something very attractive about that, but also problematic, you know? And so I think Mitchell is fascinated by this. He hopes he can learn something from Elsa. He hopes he can figure out how to, figure out her magic trick so that he can apply it in his own life and not be so panicked all the time. Of course, his life is pretty good. He has a high paying corporate job, all the money he needs, all the food he needs, etc. And yet he's in panic all the time. Yeah. Totally healthy, you know, but completely in a panic. And so he's mystified by Elsa. And those are sort of the two poles that both fascinate me. And I don't think I'm personally at either one of them, but I find both very attractive and different. For different reasons.
Do you see much of a meaningful difference between a 9/11 type disaster, man-inflicted, approximately man-inflicted, and a Seattle-leveling earthquake or New York flood, like in your book? Both disasters, but does it mean a lot to you that one, there was actually a guy flying the plane, and the other one, no one did anything directly?
Yeah, I think there's a special type of horror at a human being inflicted disaster that I think we felt again with Boston Massacre, that we've done this to ourselves in some way. You know, that this is, as much as there's an effort to paint the terrorist as some foreign outsider always, right? It's always a foreign outsider, usually someone with dark skin. The first reports of Boston Massacre, you know, dark-skinned Arab, you know, running around Boston. But really, I think what's truly horrific about these acts is that it's that we did it. You know, we did it to ourselves. And I think that element, I mean, I wouldn't put too fine a point on it, but that element is also present in discussions about climate change. Like, we're doing this to ourselves. And there's something truly horrific about that. And you know, we're messing with the chemistry, you know, of the planet, the biology. And we don't know what the, you know, what kind of Frankenstein that we're going to create. We don't really know what'll happen. And there's something, there's an extra level of horror wrapped up in that, which I think is why people are also very eager to dismiss the, you know, whenever there's a Sandy, people, you know, there's this dialogue about, well, is it because of climate change that that Sandy occurred? And I think there's a real knee-jerk response to say, of course not, of course not, there's always hurricanes. And I think that reflects the, I think the horror we feel that we might be inflicting this on ourselves.
Does it make it psychologically worse or better that with 9/11, you know, any one of us could theoretically fly a plane into New York, but no one of us makes climate change happen and no one of us stops it? I mean, one of us could decide not to fly a plane into New York, and we've done our part there, but you can't cause or not cause a climate change related disaster yourself. So is that good? Is that bad? I don't know.
Well, I mean, it's fascinating. I mean, I think that gets into a lot of the attitudes. I mean, I think how you answer that question in some ways, yeah, determines what your attitude is about, climate change. Like, you know, do you buy a, you know, if you can afford it, do you buy an electric car? Are you sort of anal about recycling, you know? But you know, that position has flaws too, because of course, yeah, you could not use any, you could live off the grid for the rest of your life and you'll have almost zero, if not, you know, 0.000 effect on what's happening to the planet. And so, yeah, this is a question. This gets back to this question of, you know, how do we respond to this sort of, this looming, relatively slow developing crisis or series of crises or system of crises. And I don't know that there is an answer. I mean, that's what I wanted to write about is yeah, well, what's the responsible approach? You know, do we just sort of worry about our family and make sure that we make, you know, do you just get a job at the coal CEO to make sure that your kids can eat and your family will have money for generations, you know? Or do you become an activist and stand in the road blocking, you know, the coal trucks from entering the plant? And I don't know that there's, you know, a right answer to that necessarily. But everyone has to make that decision for oneself. Or do you just pretend the whole thing's not happening? But I don't know if that's an intellectually honest answer either. You know, so it's very thorny, and I don't feel like, one of the reasons I wanted to write this novel is because I don't feel like novelists are talking about these issues. I think nonfiction writers are doing a very artful job of talking about them. There have been a lot of books that have addressed these things in a very subtle way, not polemical books, but, you know, histories and other types of speculative nonfiction, I guess would be the best term, have done a nice, interesting job with these questions. But I don't feel like novelists are going there, and I think they will. Mm-hmm. I think it's inevitable, but I don't feel like it's happened yet, and I wanted to go in that direction.
Why do you think novelists have dragged their feet on it?
I think there's it's strange. I mean, because we've had, you know, there's a great literature, for instance, there's a great Cold War literature. You know, there's a great World War II literature, you know. And I'm not just talking about books about war or about, you know, the Hunt for Red October. I'm talking about something like White Noise, you know, novels that address allegorically or metaphorically these sort of deep-seated anxieties in the culture. And I don't think that's been happening with where we've been in the last 5-10 years and where we're going, especially around questions of climate change. And I think part of it is there's an anxiety. I think writers have been told their whole life that they're, you know, they are writers and they're not scientists. And so, and you should write about what you know, and that whole line. And I think it's, that might be part of it. There's, I think writers can be intimidated to write about money, to write about science, to write about technology, even though there's this great history of, you know, it's like who wrote about money better than Dickens, for instance. And, or, you know, Proust writing about politics and Norman Mailer and, you know, coming up to DeLillo and, you know, and Bellow and all those people. So, but I don't, I just don't, yes, the question is why aren't people doing this? I don't really know. I think it might be the MFA system that teaches a certain model. It's hard to generalize about that because there are plenty of writers that do interesting things that come out of MFA programs. But I mean, that might be one, the MFA influence could be part of it on American contemporary fiction. It could be a kind of anxiety about writing about these issues. I don't really know, because it's really, frankly, it's not that hard to learn enough. You know, you don't have to become a scientist, you know, an expert in, you know, environmental science to write about these things. You just have to do a little research in the same way that you have to do a little research if you want to write about a story about a baker or, you know, a peddler or something, you know, someone who works in a magazine at a magazine rack and on the street. Like, you don't have to do those jobs in order to write about them. And I think the level of technical knowledge that you have to write about some of these other issues is actually not as great as you might think. I never took economics in college, you know, I never took math classes in college, but you can figure it out. And I feel like, especially now when we're at a point where, you know, technology, for instance, especially, is become so central to our culture. I think I wouldn't go so far as to say writers have to be writing about these things, but I think there's a huge, huge sort of swath of culture that is not being addressed in fiction. And I think my hope is that for the vitality of contemporary fiction, that novelists go there. And I think they will, and they have in the past. But I haven't seen it happening, now. I don't see it happening now, but I think it's only a matter of time. But yeah, my hope is that more novels take on these ideas.
I remember reading, I'm pretty sure this was by you, a review of the latest Tom Wolfe novel. And Tom Wolfe seems to be the last, for now, of that breed of super established, super researchy novelist, right? I mean, there's been a big gap since him, I guess. Is it? Do you think that's true?
Yeah, and I think there's also, you know, it's the question of the quality of the research. I mean, I think the problem with the new Tom Wolfe novel is that he did a lot of research. There's no doubting, you know, he spoke to a lot of people, and he experienced a lot of things, but it doesn't come off as authentic, because I think there's some, you know, he's writing about characters that, in part because they're, you know, they're 50 or 60 years younger than him, there's certain cultural differences that he didn't quite get. So I guess you could say there's actually a failure of reporting there.
Maybe research isn't enough, or don't believe to yourself that research is enough.
Right. Oh, no, it's definitely not enough. And you have to do something imaginative with it to make it real. And I didn't feel like that novel achieved that very well. But, I think some of his earlier novels did, to a greater extent. But yeah, you know, someone like DeLillo writes about these things really well. Even, you know, a T.C. Boyle, he's written a lot of great novels about big ideas that are extremely entertaining, so people don't really think of them that way. Of course, you know, Joan Didion. And there are a lot of people of that generation who are more, you know, politically involved, and politically in the broadest sense of the word. And I don't see that happening as much now. I mean, just a little, you know, you see it here and there, but there aren't, it's just not in vogue anymore. Sort of engaging with big ideas. I think that you don't see that in fiction. And I don't think the way to do it is to make it polemic, you know, or to make it preachy. You know, I think anything that can be expressed in an essay is better expressed in an essay than in a novel. But I think to get at these larger, more ambiguous, complex questions, what the novel has a very important thing that it can contribute that an essay cannot contribute, which is that it can make it intensely personal. It can take these larger, more abstract ideas and refract it through a person's life, a character's life. And that's the power of great fiction, right? I mean, it can makes these sort of the public private. And, mm-hmm. and I think there's a real demand for that now. I haven't, you know, as a reader, that's what I want to feel that novelists are grappling with these big themes. And I think nonfiction writers are there, but I think there's real opportunity for novelists to do this.
What do you find it important to do then to, I suppose, realify a Mitchell or an Elsa who hold, they're on the ends of the spectrum, as you said, in terms of how they think about disasters, how they regard all this evidence that you processed yourself. How do you take the ends of the spectrum and then make them real people?
Yeah, well,
not every single step of the process, but generally.
Yeah, I mean, I think Mitchell starts off at one extreme, but then there's a huge transformation and a fairly gradual transformation that takes place. And yeah, it doesn't work if the characters are just two-dimensional representations of ideas. Mm. It becomes, diagrammatic, and it's kind of boring. Mm. But the characters have to be flesh and blood characters who are full of contradictions and conflicting impulses. And I think Mitchell is that way. And Elsa's more abstracted, but she plays a less central role in the novel. And she ultimately, you realize that she is also more complex than she might seem at the beginning of the novel. So yeah, the trick, it's the old, you know, it's just, it's the same that it's what's true of all good writing, is that good novels, the characters are vivid, human, full of conflicting emotions and ideas, and hopefully a reader can see himself or herself reflected in the character in some way. Mm. And I think great fiction does that. And yeah, the danger in writing about these things is getting too caught up in, or is entering the realm of sort of polemics or a kind of, geometric representation of these issues instead of bringing it to life. You have to make it intimate and personal. And so that's what I tried to do in the novel.
And the element of the comic as well, would you say you include jokes in your book? Or, I mean, there's things that readers laugh at a lot in your books. Are there jokes in your books?
There are a few jokes, but it's more, I hope that there's a lot of humor. And I see it as a kind of, I feel like horror and comedy are two sides of the same coin, and they work in very similar ways. And that sort of in great horror, like in great comedy, you are shocked by something happening, but the shock contains within it a revelation, and you glimpse through the shock some element of truth and something that, some emotional truth, right? And you can either laugh at that surprise can either cause you to laugh or it can horrify you, depending on which way it's played. And so my hope in the novel is that it kind of traces that fine sort of razor's edge between those two, and so that, you know, maybe some readers might read something as horrific and others read it as comical. And I think that's true of a lot of the sort of obsessive, crazy worst case scenarios in the book, is that they're all real. So there's something horrific about them, but they also can be played for comedy. Mm. And I think you have to acknowledge that they're both are elements that are part of obsession. You know, obsession contains both.
Well, I mean, disasters are so much about the improbable, and both horror and comedy are also about the improbable, aren't they?
Absolutely. Yeah. It's about surprise. Mm. Surprise with an emotional punch.
Mm. You mentioned different readers seeing different elements of this book, different ways they laugh or they're horrified. Is there a sense that you want them to maybe feel both at once if they can in one individual? I mean, do you think that's how possible do you think it is for someone to laugh and be horrified by the same thing at the same time in the same book?
I think it's possible. I think in some cases it's possible, but I did a reading recently where a woman came up to me. I read the opening chapter and said, you know, I really liked your book, but I was made uneasy by the reading because people were laughing throughout the chapter. Wow. And I read it as just like a horrific and a thriller, you know, like a kind of dramatic thriller. And I love that response because I think if it's really working, it can go either way. And that's, and the react, you know, which way it goes really depends on the reader. And that's what's great about fiction, is that every reader brings, you know, themselves to the task, and that, and has their own response. And that's one of the exciting things about, you know, reading fiction and also about writing fiction, to see the different responses that something can evoke.
Some of the responses that the new book, Odds Against Tomorrow, has evoked have referenced Candide. They've got another book about a disaster or with a disaster in it. And they call Mitchell a reverse Pangloss. Everything is the worst of all possible worlds, or he sees the worst of all possible worlds at all times. Do you see any resonances between the treatment of disaster and just of the bad things that can happen in life between Candide and your book? I mean, I'm not to draw any lines too directly, but is that a comparison that rings true to you at all?
It's not something I thought about writing the book, but I think there is truth to that observation. And I think there's also some similarity in the ending of the novel and the ending of Candide. But I don't think it's an exact one-to-one comparison. I mean, I think the novel ends with a little more ambiguity, I hope, or conflictedness. Mm-hmm. Although there's an element of that in Candide as well, but I think it goes a little beyond that, I would hope. But yeah, I like the reverse Pangloss. I mean, I think that's sort of a nice way to think about Mitchell, at least as he appears at the very outset of the novel.
Right. The Candide, I mean, you read that and there seems to be this sense of, you know, don't wish for anything from institutions. Institutions are not going to save you. That's not where you're going to get your happiness. And I wonder, in real life, you know, after Katrina in New Orleans, is that a lesson to draw from that debacle? Is that institutions don't necessarily know what to do? The state doesn't know what to do, despite the state did all this, you know, it's government research you were delving into to learn about disasters. But then it seems like with Katrina, they didn't really know what was going on.
That's certainly the lesson that's drawn by New Orleanians. There's a complete distrust of the government and, if anything, suspicion of conspiracy. Mm. That was present from the first days after Katrina, of course. And the Army Corps of Engineers, in New Orleans, the Army Corps of Engineers are vilified because Katrina is not seen as a natural disaster. It's seen as a man-made disaster. You know, that's the line that any New Orleanian will tell you. It's not a natural disaster. It's a man-made disaster. And the men who made it were, in large part, the Army Corps of Engineers, who built levees that weren't sufficient and created more subsidence of the soil and led to the flooding that you saw after the storm. So yeah, I think that's something that's the national mood right now for a lot of the nation. Huge distrust of authority and of government. And yeah, but at the same time, they knew what was going to happen in Sandy. I think they probably knew what was going to happen when Katrina hit. And so, yeah, they have the knowledge, but there's, absolute suspicion, border, and hostility towards them.
And it seems like there are an infinitude of ways to react to disasters and to prepare your mind for disasters. After reading your book, no one jumps out as the sensible one, right? I mean, there's not like, oh, this is how I should be about disasters. I don't know how you feel, but it seems like everybody's going to be a different way about disasters. And, you know, Mitchell can't point you in the right way necessarily.
Yeah, I mean, it's disaster, you know, real catastrophe. I mean, I think there's a line in the book, you know, real catastrophe is a kind of genius. It's something that it's a reconfiguration of the world in a way that you've never seen before, you know? And so it's chaos. It's sort of a vector of chaos introduced into your life. And so there's something deeply irrational about a catastrophe. Mm. And so the question is, well, what's the rational way to respond? There is no rational way because you're dealing with something irrational. I mean, I'm reminded of one thing I learned writing the book, doing some research for the book, is that, a common psychological response for people who are in who are experiencing catastrophes, like, for instance, people sitting on a boat that's sinking, sitting on the Titanic, or someone who's skydives and the parachute doesn't work.
Oh, jeez.
You know, and they've found that a shockingly high number of people in that situation don't do what we would say retrospectively is the reasonable, the rational, make the rational decision, which, you know, if they're on a boat, maybe run towards the lifeboat,
right.
Put on your PFD, run towards the exit, or in a skydiving, activate the safety parachute. Mm. A lot of people who die, a shockingly high percentage of people who die from skydiving accidents never tried to open the safety parachute. Mm. And so essentially what's happening is the person in that situation is encountering something that they have no pattern recognition for. They've never seen anything like it before, and they have no, so they don't know how to respond. And so they basically freeze.
Mm.
And you know, everyone would say, well, if I was in that situation, I'd pull the ripcord, you know, but people don't.
Do we have data on people who've been through disaster after disaster in life? Just people who go through a lot of disasters, are they better equipped for the next one?
There are studies of those people. Really? I've read them. And
who are they?
Oh, man, usually it's something freakish. It's where it, you know, in order to even experience catastrophe on that level more than once is obviously unusual. But yeah, they have some capability. You know, they're able to have the presence of mind to pull the cord or to run out towards the boat, and that in part is how we know about the people who didn't make it. Like, I mean, I read one account of a guy who was in that situation where his cruise ship was sinking, and he instantly thought, well, I'm going to go up, you know, he figured out exactly how to leave the boat, the safest way, you know, he figured it out very logically in the moment. And he tried to get other people to come, and some people did, but a lot of people just said, oh, it'll be fine. Uh-huh. You know, things will get, and
this will unsink.
Yeah, this you know, this is probably normal. They'll fix it. You know, someone will fix it. We'll be fine. And some people just don't have that capacity. So it is a certain sensibility that you have to survive those situations. And some people have it and some don't. But the you know, the problem is you don't know if you have it or not until you're actually in the situation.
Mm. I remember reading in the book, Mitchell says once or thinks, yeah, the Jews are pretty good as far as envisioning disaster, but this Christians, man, look at the disasters they have. The religious perspectives on disasters, religions all seem to have them. I mean, don't they? Or am I wrong? Is it just Jews and Christians worrying a lot?
Yeah, I think it's a very primitive, it's part of who we are. Mm-hmm. And I think it comes from the fact that earlier in history, in pre-civilization, there was a catastrophe, a real catastrophe every day. You were attacked by a wild animal. You know, the other person in the cave tried to take a rock to your head. You're fighting over the girl. You know, we actually live in. I mean, part of the humor of obsessing about worst case scenarios is that we're at a time where we've never been safer in many ways. You know, it's like, I'd rather be living now than in you know, plague years of Europe, you know, 14th century pre-medicine era, right? The Black Plague's coming for you. Mm-hmm. So, but I think we have built into our DNA, a survival instinct, really. So I guess what we're talking about, but maybe it's been muted because of a sense of safety that we've developed over the last centuries.
Mm-hmm. And Mitchell envisions these world-sweeping disasters, you know, a virus that kills humanity or what have you. I was going to ask, why have we experienced so few world-sweeping disasters? But I guess the low probability tells you why. But then again, I mean, it seems like by now we must be due for something that is not contained, right?
Yeah, we're due. there haven't been... There's something... It's been like 40 years since they've developed new antibiotics. I mean, we're reaching this point where when we have some kind of antibiotic resistant super flu, we'll be in real trouble. That's sort of that's one of the scarier scenarios of the worst case scenarios in the book. And yeah, and I guess the other part of the question is like, yeah, you'd think we're due, but really our individual kind of historical timeline is really small. Mm-hmm. So yeah, you know, things have been pretty good for the last 30 or 40 years. We've just had, you know, some terrorism and some wars and some, yes, you know, pretty large natural disasters, but we haven't had a repeat of the 1918, you know, flu, for instance. But 1918 wasn't that long ago, you know, and so, you know, these things will come around again. And if anything, with the way that we're sort of we're transforming the ecology of the planet, some of these things will happen at an increasing rate. But yeah, whether or not these things, you know, certain events happen in our lifetimes is another question, but they will happen.
Do any of them keep you up at night personally?
No.
Not a one?
I mean, the super volcano kept me up for a while. I mean, I've developed like certain neuroses about, you know, I don't hold a cell phone next to my head. I don't go through airport security.
How do you get out of airport security?
You get patted down.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, opt out of the...
There's only so much they can do to you patting down.
Yeah, I mean, they feel you up, and they are often very forceful out of anger that they're being forced to do this. But that's my own sort of passive civilian disobedience. But no, I don't panic about any of these things because it's ultimately abstract. It's out of my control, and I have moments where I get freaked out about certain things, and I think maybe I shouldn't live near a coast, things like that. But not so much that I actually act on it. And I think that's how most of us are, is that we have moments of obsession, but then moments of a kind of ignorance is bliss attitude.
I could buy cans of food, but screw it.
Yeah, exactly. Well, living in New Orleans, actually, you do have to buy water because we're constantly having boil water advisories because the plumbing is so bad. But yeah, you know, especially living in a place like New Orleans where everyone's prepared for catastrophe all the time, it becomes kind of the baseline.
I've been speaking here at Los Angeles Review of Books headquarters in Silver Lake with Nathaniel Rich, author of San Francisco Noir, author of The Mayor's Tongue, author of the new book, Odds Against Tomorrow. Nathaniel, thanks so much.
Thanks for having me.
This has been the Los Angeles Review of Books podcast. I've been Colin Marshall, and you can find much more at lareviewofbooks.org. Thanks.